Okay. Let me do a quick thing around what this is. So yesterday afternoon, we got to a space of asking the question around what possibilities, I'm going to have to look for Jane here for the question, what possibilities are emerging that create pathways for our direction, for our development or direction forward. And out of that, you had conversations at your table, and then one person at the table was a table host, and the other people were travellers, and we got to cross-fertilise that. How many people kind of are back here because they like that energy of that yesterday afternoon, even though you're dog tired? Yeah? Yeah? You liked it? Yeah. Yeah, because you got to have small conversations and get creative and listen to each other. At the end of yesterday afternoon, we collective, as a group, you put up your ideas and possibilities of going forward into that. So let's just backtrack and set this up as we want to finish. And this is where I come back into being a school teacher with grade 9 boys, trying to get them into a straight line. It's like herding cats. But anyway, can we check this off? Have you got 4 people at your table with only 4 chairs around? If there's a 5th chair, take it to the side, please. So if there's a 5th chair at your table, take it to the side. Can we take that chair out? Yeah, thank you. Sorry? Is that somebody's stuff? We might just need to take it, the whole stuff over. Yeah. It just means that when we start rotating, it doesn't work. So is there anyone that's not got at a table that was looking for a space? You looking for a space? Yep, great. Paul, you could be, anyone got a spare place? That's okay. 1-5 and 1-5 only, Paul, you get to choose wherever you want to be. Which table do you want to join? Grab a chair. And that's the only table that's got a 5. Okay, that's okay. We might allow 2 5s. I'll be flexible. See, I'm getting very J-ish now, aren't I?
You are. You've got to extreme J.
Okay. So the second thing is, at your table, decide who is going to be your table host, and that person to stick on the table host label. Remember, a table host is someone that hosts. They invite people to come and hear the story of the conversation that's been. And they're interested in the tales of the travellers that bring to this new country. So decide quickly. You've got 30 seconds to decide who your table host is going to be. The table host badge that they haven't got one.
Yep.
Okay. Now, can I just see? So we've got this instruction how we want it to be. Table host, please. Let's see. Can I see the table host by standing up, please? Great. Great. Thank you. Now. Just know what country you are at. You will know by the photo that's at your table. Now, those that were here yesterday, was it useful to know right at the beginning? Because when you came home at the end, you remembered. Yeah, so if you don't remember your table, so we've got...
Where is that from?
That's Prague. Yeah, that's Czech. Czechoslovakia. We've got... What other countries are in the room today? UK, Japan, Thailand, Paris,
Germany.
USA, Germany, Ireland, China. Let me have a guess. Let's go. Is it either going to be Sweden or Alaska? Let's go.
Alaska.
Alaska is what
Let's
you determine.
Let's go Alaska. Let's
Aussie.
Go.
Exotic. Where?
Mainland
Australia. The other place. That
other
we're
places. Making.
Yeah. Don't you have koalas down here?
No.
Oh. Okay. Any moons today? Have we got any outer space people today? No,
only Alex.
Alex is out of space down there. We might actually think we've got enough for four for another table coming this way, I think.
Yeah, we pretty much have for four.
Let's make another table. If you're a five, Paul, who else? And John?
And there's Sunny.
And so Sandy can come up to this one up here. Yeah, up to this one. So take your chair out. Take your chair out, Paul. And John, if you come up to one of these.
It'll be fine.
And one of you be the table host. And you're going to have Sandy joining you in a second. Okay. Now, the question that we're wanting to explore today is this one on... don't worry. It was about Commitment Corner. What can we commit to? What's it? Someone read the program? What can we commit to?
Oh, is there a program?
What commitments will we make today that can transform our great ideas, yesterday and today's formation, into a collective reality? That's the question. It will come up in a second. But before we do that, we want to give you a bit more stimulus to try. Some of you will have seen this before, but it's very energetic, very short, very sharp. It's called the Lone Nut, or the Dancing Guy and the Lone Nut, and it's about leading the future and the possibilities. So just so we can put our eyes on this screen up here, we might kind of, if we're feeling we're lagging towards the end, we might get a bit of injection of energy here. Thank you, Georgie.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
Lovely. Alex appreciates that one. Who's seen that before? Anyone? Yeah. But it kind of generates some stuff with us about. So what I'm going to invite you into is being your lone nut here. And this circle at the end is going to kind of invite followers to join you in being a lone nut and converting your lone nut into a movement. So what I'm going to suggest, Georgie, have the question back up again, please. But what you've got some resources in the room to start thinking about what are the commitments we will make today that can transform our great ideas into a collective reality. You might want to revisit the post-it notes over there and bring them, the ones that are relevant to you, to bring back to your table. You might want to go and get your ideas and over there and bring them back so that you can start this conversation. In about 15 minutes, I'm going to get you to move on and see if you can lead, take your lone nut with you, and see if you can get some connections with followers around the room. And towards the end of this conversation, we'll take it to a collective here. So I invite you into this space. Remember, talk, discuss, generate ideas, generate possibilities to commit to, and then we'll go travelling with them and see what you can do with them. Have fun. I've lost my belt. Remember to go back and revisit your post-its if they're good enough. You want to keep them going. Get your ideas off here to bring to your table to get them into some ideas of what can we commit to? What do we want to commit to collectively as a group? Thanks, Sam. Remember, we don't have to start with the biggest step. It can be the small thing that we want to commit to, which might lead to other things. Think small in order to go big. If we go too big, we'll probably not get there. Good. Really get these ideas crunchy, because you're going to go look for your followers soon, so you can get as much detail into this idea. You want to find your followers. Remember, make it clear, make it attractive. Stretch to? Where can you take this idea? Where does it lead? This sector, the innovators in Tasmania, bringing new ideas, fresh thoughts that stretch us to new possibilities. I'm going to give you about 3 more minutes of this space at your country to really firm up your idea to go find your followers. Say goodbye. Go find your followers.
Pack your bags.
Pack your bags. There are followers out there looking for your idea to join.
Pick up
Invite
your hand
them
luggage.
To follow you. Be easy.
Say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Farewell.
Take
Travel
your
well.
Idea. See if you can attract a follower.
Hosts, welcome your traveler friends. You are welcoming. Travel well, Sonny.
Thank you.
you're trying to sell your idea to each other to attract followers. You're going to have to make it exciting to follow, attractive, easy to follow. See if you can grab some followers. If you're loving an idea that you're hearing, where's your commitment? What could you commit to this idea to make it a reality tomorrow, to start? Where's your energy drawing you to? Ooh. Which ideas are attracting you to commit to? Which ones are getting your energy? Which ones do you want to sign up to and be involved with? What do they... Oh, so he's... Okay, time to go. Take your... Find more followers. Find more followers. Take your ideas. Build on them. Gather people of interest.
Well, you're off again.
They'll tell you, see if you can hook into their ideas.
Well, nice and welcome. Welcome your travellers.
Just so you all know, we haven't checked out. We're just on the balcony.
Ooh.
I'd like to invite you to return to your home countries, please. Return home. This is the test. Can you remember where home is? It's all right for the hosts.
Thank you for coming. Bye-bye.
Say your fond farewells. Pack your souvenirs. Travel well back to your home countries. Bring back your tales from far, exotic lands.
Can I add something to it?
Share your stories.
I corrected someone else before. I'm like, there's more to that saying. Nothing about me, without me, is for me.
Hosts. Welcome the travelers back home. Find the things you can commit to. How will this show up in your practice?
Followers, did you attract? How did your ideas transform? What are you committing forward to take to the bigger group? What energy is with your idea?
Ooh.
Who are you following? What ideas did you hear that you want to get on their team? You want to follow them? Turn a lone nut into a leader. Can I invite people to come and join us in the circle over here? Take up a seat. You just need yourself to come and join us in the circle. Does it matter which number? Everyone.
Okay.
Join us in the circle over here. We have the microphones out, yes. Jane, Andrew, joining us. Who else is? Martina? Okay. So, I imagine there were some lone nut ideas around the room that you got a bit excited about that you'd like to follow and commit to. So, we just want to throw it open to people who want to say, this is my lone nut idea that I want to commit to, and I'm looking for followers to take a mic, lean into the vulnerability, to go in there and see who's actually, what followers do you attract? There's some great ideas out there, weren't there, Dr. Markwood?
There were some fantastic ideas out there. Really lovely.
Can you just walk in
now, just so Georgie doesn't do a head spin, just show her the mic before you talk so she knows which one you've got. Okay.
Can you say hello?
Hello?
No. Two. There we are. Okay. So I've been well and truly told that I get on my high horse about this. I'm going to try and keep it to at least a pony, not a proper draft horse. But I guess my kind of weird idea from today is about when we're working with our consumers and when we're working with people, we tend to focus on their strengths. We don't try and sit there and talk about this is what's wrong with you, this is what's bad, this is what you're not doing well. And I think a lot of the time when we're talking about our own systems and our own services, we focus on what's not going well and we can be really quite negative about it. But I think if a strengths focus is good enough for the people we work with, why isn't it good enough for us? And maybe we can start to focus on the strengths. And a great example that Sam here came up with, so I'll call her out in front of the group and embarrass her a little bit, was small communities. There's lots of them in Tasmania, and there's a lot of talk of, you know, we don't have in small communities access to the funding and the range of services, and that's a negative. But there's also strengths in small communities. So, you know, there's often a lot more natural supports and a lot more community spirit and a lot more kind of informal connectivity that people can have access to. So, yeah, let's spend a bit of time focusing on
our
strengths.
So what are you committing to?
I guess focusing on the strengths within, you know, working from a strengths-based approach in trying to do system reform. This is what I'm committing to. Daisy, not what you're committing to.
So were you looking for followers in your commitment? What would they want to follow you in doing?
On focusing on the strengths, on focusing on our services' strengths and our system strengths and our own strengths and working off that rather than just looking at what's not working.
Any followers?
Oh, nice.
Looking, and what are you going to do with these noticing of where systems are actually working well in people's lives? How are you going to keep this alive? How do you turn this into a movement, the lone nut with its followers into
We're
a movement?
We're going to talk about it. We're going to shout it from the rooftops and tell everyone how damn good we are sometimes. Not all the time, but most of the time. And tell people, share our good news stories, tell politicians. We are never going to get funding and we are never going to move forward unless we can show them our worth and our value.
So stop hiding your work underneath a bushel.
Be proud of what we do.
How will you keep the dance going around that? This is a commitment I hear coming up.
I hear an extension of our idea of 101 ways to escape the system and further developing that along the lines of strength-based practice wherever you go.
Wow. And what's your idea that you want? Your lone nut idea that you are looking for followers around the 101 ideas of escaping the system? Because not everyone's heard your idea.
How would you put it into words?
Who's in your lone nut team here that you came up with that? Jason's got some. What are you committing to?
Well, what we're thinking about is basically getting people to share their stories about escaping the system. There's a lot of stuff out there, but there's nothing personal, really personal, that you know. If you want to share your story, it's something that you can remain anonymous or you can share it and be public about it. And I think that if we get these stories and we put them somewhere where people can access them, like the internet or in a book, that's sort of an idea.
So ideas of not how to get stuck and my illness stories, but ideas of how I've actually got my Jennifer Beale or my Bette Midler or found my way out.
Exactly.
Creativity stuff, escaping the system to get my life back.
Absolutely. And I think everyone has a story to tell, whether it wants to be an anonymous story or not. I think everyone in this room has a story, and I think it's really important that we get
escape
those stories,
stories,
and share that, and also to make a commitment to yourself. So my commitment today is to finish my Cert 4 in mental health peer work, and then after that I want to, if there's another conference like this, is actually supply an abstract and
start the idea.
Get some stuff out there.
Nice.
Yeah.
And this book idea or website idea, has that got some energy? Have you got some followers with you? Did you get some followers around the room as you were talking about your following? How, what's your commitment to follow? How are you going to follow them? Oh, we need a mic. Hang on. Number one, Georgie.
Dominique. When I work with people, sometimes people do that kind of stuff. They tell their story along those lines, but often it's about the history and where they are now and where they want to go. But the story isn't often around...
escaping.
Kelly's story this morning, and it's those kind of stories that are really inspiring and not just keep individuals going or those people working services going, but I think it's also got potential to shape services.
You've got a question.
And although it's important,
about
Helen,
planning
and although it's important,
sorry.
Although it's important for us to be able to tell our funding bodies what a great job we're doing, I think it's also really important to tell those stories, because that really is community education, and they're the stories that will also, I think, sometimes be the tipping point for the funding bodies.
And when you give them voice, they become more visible. I was just thinking when you were talking there, a great planning question about how can we work together to help you escape the system as you're...
Yeah.
What's the plan of escape here? The Houdini.
Oh, no, I didn't want a microphone. I thought I spoke loud enough. You could call it the Houdini.
How to escape.
The Houdini Book of Great Escapes.
Yeah. What other ideas, what other lone nut innovations are you looking for followers on that you want to put up to the group?
I guess this was kind of a nutty idea. We sort of came up with an art piece, and I think there was a diversity of experiences or interpretations that came out of that creation in the group. But being Germany, we sort of thought of the idea of some sort of a sausage machine. And there was this sort of like chronological experiences going into the sausage machine that the consumer might have, whether it be constructs in the media, government policies, friendships, family, diagnosis, isolation. And we had sort of a sausage that was coming out the end. The end, I guess, is like the collective, which turned into a rainbow sausage. So the idea that it shouldn't be one fixed deterministic outcome, that we are actually embracing the unknown. And I guess a rainbow of the unknown is a bit more optimistic. And another participant talked about the NDIS is, I guess, a little bit of one of those question marks. And I guess I read something interesting a few weeks ago about the concept of understanding, I guess, is embracing the unknown, because we're not trying to overstand the person and assume and know all about the person. We're understanding, we're underneath them. And yeah.
So the commitment there for you in going forward about what you want people to follow you doing?
It's hard to answer that, because my practice framework is very much about teasing out what the participant creates to go forward, their art piece, so to speak. So I guess I kind of, I don't know if I'm sounding a bit too esoteric or metaphorical here, I like to be more of a gardener, so I can plant the seeds, give the appropriate water and the nutrients for whatever is in that person. Yeah.
So you're wanting us to follow you to be gardeners?
Pardon?
You're wanting us to embrace our gardener within?
As a worker, being a gardener, to try and facilitate the ideal environment for that person to blossom. Yeah. But I think there's also a little bit of an unknown with where we're going in the future, but trying to, I guess, ride those waves of uncertainty rather than fight them. Yeah, surf them. Yeah.
So is the commitment there to ride the uncertainty wave for you?
Pardon?
Is there a commitment there about how will I do that? What am I committing to ride this uncertainty wave?
I guess what I would say is, for me, I don't like to have a one-size-fits-all approach. I see any model, whether it be strengths, cognitive, narrative, whatever, as being a little bit like a fisherman's net. There's always going to be stuff that falls through the net. And often we might pick up a few starfish as well, or unknown. So trying to sit down and create an intervention with the participant, and that might be very much a strength-based position, but also I think that if I'm trying to go through that process of connecting with a participant, I might feel patronising to hit them with strength straight away, but something we learn in Lifeline training is having the turning point, so when they start talking about one of their strengths, I can really then tease that out or put some fertiliser or water on it, so to speak.
So they're going to meet you before the theory.
Pardon?
They're going to meet you before the theory.
Going to meet me before the theory, but also looking at how the practice interrogates the theory. Yeah.
Any followers joining here that's interesting to kind of get involved in?
Yeah.
And how to keep that alive and how to turn it into a movement is the next thing to start thinking about, and keep that flame and flint going around that. Other innovations that you're, lone nut innovations that you're looking for followers to join you? Paul's got one.
Just wanted to add to it, that whole concept of the gardener. I just instantly thought helping people become their own gardener. So, yeah, it was probably more of a continuation on of what you said. But, yeah, while I've got this thing, because I don't want it back, I thought of a bit of a commitment in that not to fall into a comfort zone, as, you know, and that goes for any of us, regardless of the position or role that we may hold, you know, in our own view. But, yeah, and, you know, just to sort of, to help us, you know, challenge ourselves.
So is that help zone? Help us become more creative. You're looking to stay in the zone of disequilibrium?
Yeah, so leaning into a challenge.
Yeah, that's it. Get off the comfort zone.
Get off the couch.
Yeah, get off the couch.
Yeah. You got just to grow.
Are you looking for followers to join you in that? If we're all in the zone of disequilibrium together. Okay. Yeah, I think I need to be in that one
me
a bit.
Too.
Wow.
Has anybody over the last 3 days not entered a zone of disequilibrium? Our work here is done. But that's great. And that's my experience of what we've done together is to step into that space and be prepared to be vulnerable at different levels, different times, in different ways, but to challenge ourselves. So, you know, I just invite you to kind of to notice that and to remember that and to take that into our practice.
I'm just struck by the room over there, the cradle room, was actually where all the disruption actually took place. Disruption took place.
Yes, we would recognise the courage it took for people who'd stepped into that room once to step into it again.
But being named the cradle room?
I know, it was interesting that it was called the cradle room and it was probably the most disruptive space that we've had. but people, you know, people have really engaged and I hope will take away that actually it's okay to take that step into that discomfort because it is a generative place.
So Paul, you're challenging us to stay in our zone of disequilibrium and to recognise when we're on the couch.
That's the suggestion.
Are we inviting each other to help us to do that? Who is going to tell you?
Who are you asking to help you stay there, Paul?
Who will help you?
Is there an offering to help Paul stay in his, in each other? You'll send an email. You're going to get an email.
What's this email going to say?
Okay.
Yeah.
A general email. Who's going to stay in our zone? Are we in our zone of disequilibrium today? There's a mic. Let's grab another one.
I added, after talking to Paul about that whole staying in the zone of disequilibrium. About being able to challenge each other to stay in that through the conflict that we did in the last session, through challenging each other, seeking out work colleagues or other people in the sector that we know aren't going to just agree and tap us on the shoulder and say, hey, you did a great job, but are going to look at us and go, hey, you know, that worked, or, oh, did you think of doing this?
And
or,
can we stretch?
I would have done this, or and that's going to keep us out of that safe zone.
Yeah. So you're committing to using that product and stretching into it?
I'm committing to challenging other people and hopefully other people will commit to doing that for me as well.
Yeah, so we do it for ourselves and we do it for others. We all commit to stretching and being stretched.
Mm. Yeah. Any other lone nuts out there with ideas looking for followers? There's two mics there, so you can grab a...
Many mics.
I'll give you a...
You haven't spoken. I'm so sorry.
Through there, so...
I suppose for me, like, one of our questions that came up was, like, how do you want to be understood? And, like, I didn't necessarily want to be understood or have understanding of my problem, but I want to be accepted that I might have one. And, you know, and so, like, for a worker or for... you know, to actually be in that zone whenever I meet anybody else. And so, like, I don't want to assume, you know, you talked about the man on the plane, you know. And I assumed, or, you know, like a person might come to me, you know, we might have an interview and they might smell a smoke or gone and had a few sips before they come because they might be a bit nervous or whatever. And, like, you know, I might be sensitive to that smell and I might think, oh, you know, drinker.
Yeah.
You know, straight up, I've made an assumption. But I think, like, for me to go in and have, you know, to go into my workplace and just have that zone of acceptance around me straight up. And I have to, you know, learn that in myself. And I want to be that, you know. That's what I'm committing to for myself.
Wow. You're looking for followers to do that for themselves too?
Yeah. Follow.
Yeah, we've got some hands, yeah.
Aware of the assumptions we're making. Yeah. And look for acceptance in other people, is that what you're saying? Look for where we join.
Yeah, and and to not need to listen to a story to accept. You know, sometimes, you know, we expect people to be able to explain themselves. And like one of my examples I did was about gay marriage. And, you know, we might not understand that, but let's accept it. You know, let's have that acceptance. I mean, you know, and sometimes we might not want to walk in somebody else's shoes. We might not be able to walk and have that empathy. But let's accept.
Yeah. Yeah, wow. Got some followers
well,
there.
Well, actually, mine probably leads off from that because I guess fairly simply what I would like everyone to do as much as possible, perhaps every day, ideally with everyone you meet, that might be a bit much, but just pause and put yourself in their position as in how would you like to be treated. And that works both ways very much, and that's something I think I've recognised even more throughout this. As consumers, we can often be pretty harsh on you guys as well, so we need to actually sometimes...
Try and get in each other's shoes. Yeah.
Yeah. Meet together as equals.
Is that attracting some people to follow that idea?
Yeah, we've got some hands, yeah.
Yeah, wow.
I'm having a moment.
Do you need a pill?
I may need a tissue. No, I'm really struck by that. I find that very powerful. Meet together as equals and accept each other as equals. I think there's a number of echoes in there, actually. That's really lovely.
I can remember this exercise that I did in it was a whole other story, but it was a kind of an experiential thing. But there's all these different shoes. You took off your shoes, and there were some other shoes as well. And you chose to sit, and they had work boots and gum boots and high heels and sandals, and you got into someone else's shoes, and you tried to tell the story of the person who wore these shoes originally. And that just struck me, but that's maybe something that just in our minds, if I stood in your shoes, how would I understand your story?
An experiential workshop experiencing dementia, and that was very much of stepping into the shoes and clothes and space of a person living with dementia. And that was probably the most powerful experience that I had in trying to understand what it was like for a person living with that condition. And I think one of the things we're really good at in Australia is celebrating. We celebrate, you know, the Melbourne Cup, the football. We celebrate all of these big events, Australia Day, you know, the whole thing. But we forget to celebrate each other and things that we do on a daily basis. And I think, you know, I'm making a commitment every day that I will celebrate some achievement in somebody each day. So even the tiniest thing that changes for a person is good cause for a massive celebration. Don't underestimate the capacity of somebody making a very small change to being the catalyst of something much bigger.
The spectacular in the ordinary.
Absolutely. That's exactly what it is. Yeah.
The whole world.
So you're committing to that. Can you attract others to commit to that, to look for the spectacular in the ordinary? Every day, every day. Have we seen the spectacular in the ordinary? Have we named it? Have we acknowledged it?
And sometimes that's really hard. It's like, you know, I work alongside a young person who has conduct disorder and very violent behaviours and smashing windows and destroying vehicles and all sorts of things, you know. But the one day that he put his fist to the window but didn't break it was a celebration.
Yeah.
How much control did that take for you not to smash that?
Yeah.
That was awesome. That was a brilliant choice, you know.
Lovely.
And so
they're
often goes unsighted and unnamed.
Yep.
Another commitment.
Should we have to... you've been waiting ages.
So.
Two. We're on.
It's on.
You're on.
Just speak. Maybe
swap the... That's it.
There you go.
There you are. You're on.
I feel like I need to break into song, but I'm not going to.
Oh, please
soon.
Do.
Soon.
No. Something that Renee said this morning really called to me. It was about vulnerability and What's her name? Brené Brown.
Brown. Brené Brown.
And I've seen that talk, and I spoke to my group about that, that there, he was this hard-headed researcher that had to go through and admit her vulnerability after a year of therapy, realised that actually vulnerability is almost a rite of passage to self-discovery, strength, and actually knowing yourself. And I also attended a workshop where they talked about vulnerability as a strength, that it takes strength to admit that you're not coping. It takes strength to admit or ask somebody for help, a stranger. It takes strength to tell people your story with all its bumps and ugliness that you feel and all your feelings. It takes strength to do that. And we all have vulnerability. We all have it. It's all part of who we are. And it's an intrinsic part of discovering who you really are. And in this research, it talked about the people that coped the best were the ones that saw vulnerability as an inevitability, that it was part and parcel of life. And I just really, that my commitment is to speak as, with vulnerability as a strength in all my conversations.
Mm.
That's my one.
Have you got have you got followers?
Followers?
Yeah. Lean into the vulnerability.
Mm. And that Brené Brown talk is available on TED. Some people heard about the TED Talks. If you just Google Brené Brown,
2010, TED, and then 2012.
And they're very, very watchable. Mm. They're just short.
I'm a little bit different. My situation is a little bit different to all of you guys, in that I don't work in the industry, in an organisation, so to speak. I work on my own. I just started a project that I do voluntarily. I created a group for guys coming out of rehabilitation, just a friendship group. So when they come out of rehab, they've got somewhere to go that they can develop a whole new friendship base, because you know they've got to get a house and a job, etc. And that's an unscalable mountain for a lot of these guys.
Mm.
And so naturally, in that process of trying to do all that, they fall back into the state of hopelessness and go back to their comfort zone of their old friends. And so that's where I am at the moment. And so I'm not bound per se by all the laws and stuff that govern you guys, and being here these 3 days has really brought a lot of things to light for me. And I just first of all like to say thank you to all of you. You've just increased my understanding of things so much and given me some new perspectives and a new drive. I've looked at the work I do and thought, you know, what difference am I making? But the truth of the matter is that the guys I deal with, as terrible as it sounds, have use-by dates. They've come out of situations, two guys particularly have been through rehab 8 times.
Mm.
And so can you imagine their hopelessness, that where they are? Last week, they were both suicidal. So I'm continually going into the houses of these guys. They give me the keys to their houses because they don't trust themselves. And so they say, if you think I'm in trouble, or I don't answer the phone, kick my door down, come and help me. And so I do that, and I'll go in there, and I'll be smoking drugs, I'll be doing what they're doing, getting drunk, and I just sit with them. Sometimes we sit there for hours and say nothing, but I just sit there, late nights, early mornings, up the psych ward, trying to get these guys admitted. And it's a tough call, you know. I guess the point that I'm trying to make here is what I've learned, particularly through these few days, is that these guys actually, I've been able to help them get rid of their use-by date. If you think of a loaf of bread with a tag on it, a use-by date, that's these guys. They wear that tag around all day and they're aware of it. And for them to be able to get that tag and flick it off is just enormous. And they say to me, if you weren't there for me in that moment, and it's not a moment, it's all those moments that, if you like, I gave up my life which for me is nothing because that is my life. The only thing that matters to me, my psychologist really recently said to me, these are not your friends, these are your clients. And I said, these people are like brothers to me. That's the level that I have to work with these people. They've worked with you before on your level, but these poor fellows weren't able to succumb to the help that you were giving them. So the only level that's left is this really deep level of friendship. The only way they can communicate what's happening inside of them is through friendship, not through any other service except friendship. And so sitting in a pub with a woman a few months ago, it took me 5 hours. I was desperately hungry. I hadn't eaten all day. And she was drunk and carrying on. And so I was listening. I was really interested. She's at the end of the road. And so she shared stuff with me. And I said, have you ever shared that with your psychologist over the last 20 years? She said, well, no. I said, why not? She said, well, I don't know. I never thought of it. I said, what made you think of it now? She said, you're not judging me. You're sitting here loving me. And so I guess I'm not an out there person. I'm actually quite the introvert. To see this guy on this video up there dancing something way, a galaxy away from where I'd go. But yet, I guess this conference has solidified in me that I feel like that guy in the work I do. I get a lot of negative feedback from institutions telling me that I'm crossing boundaries and I'm putting myself in danger zones, putting these people in danger zones, etc. But what has happened here this week has reiterated to me that what I'm doing and the way I'm doing it is just what is necessary.
So
I'm going to be happy to stand up and dance.
I'm hearing an invitation for people to follow you, and I'm wondering how many people hear this invitation too. The healing of friendship, the healing of doing what it takes, the healing of being with.
Yeah. Being the person I need to be.
Never giving up.
Never give up hope. Because I work in a situation where sometimes you, in the back of your, somebody will say something about a client that is coming, and in the back of your mind, immediately you put up your defenses, and you think, oh, you know, this person is very dependent, and this is how it's going to be, you know. And you think, oh, and you sort of looked at the client a little bit differently because you have been influenced by what has been said, right? Mm. And I was made aware of that the other day. I thought, oh God, what am I doing? You know, I'm judging this person based on what the information I receive from past experiences of this client. Mm. So we should really read up, don't listen to anybody, just judge as we see. And persist with our help, persist with honouring their attempts at
just add to that. I tend to agree. In the organisation I work in, we get a diagnosis and a care plan and a warning signal all sent to us prior to our person coming in. I never read it. I sit down, have a cup of tea with the person, make them comfortable. Then later on, sometime in my evening shift, I will then go through the diagnosis. But I think getting to know someone on a person-to-person basis is much more caring and less clinical.
So what are you committing to continue to meet the person before
nothing,
the notes?
Nothing
about
me.
Without me?
Without me.
Have you got followers?
Nothing about you without you.
Yes, only about you without
you. Energy.
Well,
cool.
Yep.
One more commitment we probably have before
I'll
Andrew's going
last.
To wrestle the mics off us.
As all great leaders, I'm definitely not the person that come up with it. I don't even think I'm first or second, but I'll steal it. And unfortunately, I've been trained in SMART goals, specific, measurable, achievable, realistic and time-framed. By all means. And so if you're committing with me, it has to be the SMART goal. It just can't be, oh, yeah, I'm going to be a better worker. And this is more for frontline workers.
Yeah.
That
Yeah, I'm going to start CCing participants where it's possible when I'm sending emails to other workers. And within the next week, I'm going to at least send one email where the participants CC'd. So if you're committing, if you're going to be following me, you have to agree to do that too.
Who's following?
Where possible, I said. And so,
I mean, there's nothing wrong with printing it out, putting it in an envelope and sending it. You
doesn't
know?
Have to be through that medium.
So is there... I'm loving that practical... Is there any policy that anyone has at this point in time that could not start that tomorrow? Who would you have to talk to get them to lead you around, for them to join your following team? Yeah. Yeah. Stare to challenge. Thank you. I'm going to hand over to Andrew to finish it here.
Can I invite you to, those that are sitting on this side, just move your chairs in front of these other people so you can see the screen.
Do you want me to move the whiteboard out of the
way? Because there's some photos flashing around.
We'll only take a minute. Move this out of the way.
Aren't they gorgeous?
Have we got some music there as well?
I'll go and do the music. Oh, there we go. Sorted. Got to serve for the hero inside yourself. Search for the secrets you hide. I'm in the zone.
Thanks to Alex, who put that together late at night last night. He's been here about 10 hours during each day and done some fantastic work. Can I ask you to thank Alex? Got a a few other people to thank, and I'll move quickly, but because I'm moving fast, please don't think I'm being disrespectful. I'm just aware you all want to get home. I say it with a straight face, thanks to the Australian government. They did fund absolutely everything on this occasion. And we really do appreciate their support. Thanks to the consortium, the five services, Anglicare, Colony 47, Relationships Australia, MI Fellowship and Richmond Fellowship as well. Thanks to them for their support. The most humble and quiet person in the room, Jane over here, who's actually been the brains and the brawn behind the whole show. To Maria, who's not here at the moment, but has done a lot of backroom work with administrative stuff. The project officer who set up the project, Martina, is she here? Oh, there. She did bulk work in no minute's time, and really appreciate the speed at which she worked and the efficiency with which she did it. To Naomi from Leishman's. Woo! Still standing guard, we really appreciate. She has been so flexible. There's not many people who'd be still as flexible as Naomi and still smiling after it. I've mentioned Alex. I also mentioned Steve. Look at that mural. And look at those two sandwich boards at either end. We will change you through to we change with you. There's some fantastic insights there. We just love what you've done. Love your work, Dave. It's great. Steve, I mean. People from the Tail Race Centre, Georgia, who's Woo! Been doing the sound. Woo! Wouldn't you like her in your home theatre? Hayden, the chef, who's not here. We haven't seen much of him, but he has done a great job, I think. David, the guy in the black shirt and the black shorts that's been around, he's moved every table and chair 43,212 times. Alana, who's the house manager, I'm not sure what of a correct title, but she's been absolutely gorgeous. And all the team at Tail Race, they've done a fantastic job. The person who deserves the most thanks, the people who deserve the most thanks, of course, are the coffee machine people. Yay! Woo! And special thanks to Auntie Nola, yeah, to Zach, Kathy and Alida for opening the conference. To Kelly, Helen, Anne, David, Frank, Kerry, all the workshop presenters, all of you deserve a huge round of applause. Thank you. Those people that are PIR staff, do you want to stand up just so we can see who you are? Aren't they gorgeous?
Yay!
Woo! And we also have some... You can sit there. We also have some PIR consortium representatives here, and if they'd be kind enough to stand up as well. Yesterday we had a couple from Relationships Australia as well, and on Monday we had Becky from Colony. So
I can see your meetings will never be the same again, John. You'll be dancing around.
Dancing, singing.
That's my commitment.
Most of all, of course, that we owe our great thanks to those who attended. Must admit we were having trouble with our sphincter about a week or two ago and the numbers were quite low. So next time you enrol at conference, could you please enrol early so that you give us a sense of confidence, please? Thank you all very much and travel home safely.
Number
two. I just wanted to say I've heard in this room over the last 3 days words like having the right people with the right knowledge in the room, being the best we can be, and I'd just like to ask everyone if you could join with me in thanking Andrew. Yeah. A wonderful MC, and you've got us through everything on time, with humour, and we've really enjoyed your presence, so thank you.
And we're only 7 minutes late. Because you